It is magic. I think what Nick is referring to is every time astrophysicists don't understand something, they blame it on magnetic reconnection. Only the astrophysicist, not the plasma physicist, not the space physicist. I'm keenly aware that I'm speaking behind the backs of my astrophysics friends. And that's probably not well advised because they're not here to defend. That's true. My goal here is to talk to you about basics of magnetic reconnection. And unlike the talk on kinetic theory, where I relied rather heavily on theory, kinetic observations are harder, and you got a good glimpse of it from Ben Chandran's talk. Magnetic reconnection is a ubiquitous phenomenon observed in laboratory space and astrophysical plasmas. Laboratory and space provide us with some very specific data, which therefore can be used to rule out theories, which is why it is interesting as a theorist to do this sort of work, because anything you did, if that were applicable, it would not be nearly as interesting. I will begin at the very beginning, not presuming that any of you know what magnetic reconnection is. So let me define or begin with the definition of magnetic reconnection. It's helpful to first tell you when magnetic reconnection cannot occur. And all of you know this equation, the ideal MHD Ohm's law. If a plasma is perfectly conducting, that is, it obeys the ideal MHD Ohm's law, which is E plus V cross B equal to zero. I referred to this yesterday when I was talking to you about single particle orbits and pointed out to you that the presence of the E cross B drift for electrons and ions which move together give an interpretation to this equation which is useful. Nonetheless, I am not talking about particles here today. I'm focusing on fluid models where the discrete nature of particles is smoothed over, and you're looking at magnetic field lines that are embedded in the plasma. Hannes Alfvén, who is the father of MHD, proved a theorem which goes by his name. And there are two ways to speak about Alfvén's theorem. Both are seemingly physically different, but mathematically they are the statements of the same theorem, and either one of them implies the other. So what are these two theorems that Alfvén thought about? One is, imagine you have an ideal MHD plasma, and by a colored dye, you actually drew a loop, which is made up of plasma fluid elements. As these fluid elements move under the influence of the MHD equations, their Newton's law, they will quickly deform. And I've actually minimized how deformed this will be. You're looking at T1 and T2 not too well separated. If they are well separated in time, this initial loop would be horribly distorted, because the nature of the plasma fluid elements are such that they head off in all kinds of crazy directions in general in 3D. But think about it as a short time separation, so this loop still deforms. Alfvén's theorem says that if you're tracking the loop and you calculate the flux through it, flux is B dot dA integrated over the whole circuit, that will remain invariant during the entire time evolution of the plasma. No matter how contorted this loop becomes, it will always have the same amount of flux. That's one statement of Alfvén's theorem. There is another, which is the following. Imagine you have plasma elements and you draw a line through them. Let me put it differently. The line that you're drawing through them is a field line, so I should put it differently. As Dana Longkopf was telling you, magnetic field lines in a plasma have some reality. In fact, Michael Faraday, who was a very practical person and one with deep insight, put a magnet, put iron filings around it, and showed that the iron filings line up in lines which trace what are called magnetic field lines. So if anybody asks you, how will you define a magnetic field line, you can think of Faraday's experiment. So imagine you have a magnetic field line and you have plasma elements that live on it at time t equal to zero. Again, think about a short time. This field line will deform itself. Then Alphen's theorem tells you the following. If you had plasma elements tied to a particular field line at t equal to zero, they will remain on the same field line for all times. They're like beads on a wire, these plasma elements tied to a field line. These two theorems, which are seemingly different, can be shown to be mathematically equivalent. If you say one, we can derive the other, and vice versa. I won't go through the proof of that. That will take up more time than we have. But understand this, and it's actually worked out in the textbook that Don Garnett and I wrote together, and you can just leaf through the pages of it, and you will see this, both of these theorems stated and shown that they're equivalent to one another. The question is, what happens if you actually have a deviation from the ideal image to Ohm's law? And Alphen's theorem breaks down. So let's consider the possibilities. The right-hand side is no longer zero, but it has some quantity R, and with the provision that B dot curl of R, should be not equal to zero. Sorry, if it is equal to zero, then what I'm about to say will be negated. It should be an inequality sign. So if there is an R, R has the further property that dot curl cross R is not equal to zero, then you have magnetic reconnection. Example, if R is simply a celebrated Ohm's law in the system of T, and curl of B equals mu zero J, then if you take the curl of R, then this becomes minus eta, assuming eta is constant, plus curl of J. If you plug in this of J curl B over mu, you get curl cross B by mu zero, which would end up being eta L squared B by mu zero, because you use the condition that del dot B is zero. So resistivity is in fact a form of deviation from ideal image behavior to satisfy this condition. And what it will do about it is, but it's not the only thing that does it. Electron inertia on the right hand side of that equation will have some other effect. If you just have a gradient of a pressure and nothing else, the curl of gradient of pressure vanishes. That doesn't break free lines. It doesn't have it. So keep in mind this criterion, and if this is so not equal to zero, I apologize for my typo, you will have magnetic reconnection. With me? So these are the conditions when magnetic reconnection occurs. Take your favorite thing and put it in R. We call it a generalized Ohm's law, of which resistive MHT is one realization, but it could be other things. In systems where eta is extremely small, like the Earth's magnetic field, or even in the solar corona, there are other terms that can be potentially much more important than resistive MHD that will break field lines. Okay. What does it look like schematically before? What is this idea of breaking field lines? Well, the idea is, in just simple cartoon representation, you have, there should have been arrows here, that you have field lines which are coming together, if you will, and coming to that point, say, which is a vanishing point of the magnetic field. The presence of R will allow field lines to reconnect, and this will reconnect with this field line, and that will reconnect with this, and then they will be pushed out in different directions. And the bead on a wire analogy helps you understand why, if this process is energetically favorable, that the particles can tap onto the magnetic energy and be accelerated to much higher values of kinetic energy. That's why magnetic reconnection is an interesting phenomenon. Because even though, and if you look at eta j in MHT, eta can be very, very small, it actually enables field lines to do what an eta equal to zero plasma cannot do. Because if you look at an ideal plasma, if you cannot break field lines, then the field lines are constrained to move in such a way that they preserve what is mathematically called topology of the field line. And some configurations that may be there with lower energy are just not accessible, because in order to get to those configurations, you must have reconnection going on. Otherwise, you're dead in the water. Ideal MHT is powerfully constraining on plasma motions. You know, you might think that you can take a magnetic field in vacuum and move it around as you will, and you can. But as soon as you put a magnetic field in a plasma, because of Alfvén's theorem, the plasma and magnetic field become coupled together, and an ideal plasma, they move as if the field is frozen in the plasma. The frozen field theorem, that's Alfvén's theorem for you. And you put in a little bit of dissipation, new things can happen. Well, what's new things? I use the word topology, and I should make it more precise. What do I mean by topology? And this is a subtle but really important idea in magnetic reconnection that is not emphasized enough. Okay? So I'm going to emphasize it. Reconnection does not always occur. It occurs in interesting ways if the magnetic field pattern that you have enables reconnection to occur. Here is an example. What is special about this magnetic field configuration? What strikes you first? Field lines are pointing in opposite directions. So imagine first that these magnetic field lines are all in a plane, but there is a line in between, in two dimensions, where the field line actually vanishes, and then you flip to the other side, it reverses direction. You could easily have a configuration where the field lines are all pointing in the same direction. It still satisfies del dot B equal to zero. If you have a conductor and you put such a highly conducting surface and you put magnetic fields in it and it has a finite amount of resistivity, the field line will diffuse, will gradually decay away. For that, you don't need to do plasma physics. You can do Jackson CNM or any other favorite book that you have, and you can just study how magnetic field lines diffuse in a conducting medium, right? And how will it diffuse? On the time scale of resistivity of the system. But this is different. Here you have field lines pointing in opposite directions in a plasma, and when they reconnect, they can actually produce these sorts of structures which are actually called magnetic islands or plasmoids. In hydrodynamics, they're called cat's eyes. Take your favorite pick, and every community uses his own language. But in MHT, these are called islands. Now, if you look at these two configurations, they're topologically different. And you know why? look at the region in between these two. You actually have regions where the field lines are closing on themselves. In the previous configuration, you had no such structure like that. Something happens in a resistive plasma that allows you now to have two types of field lines. In these cases, the field lines are minus infinity to plus infinity, and similarly here in opposite directions. So they're all infinite field lines. What's happening here? These field lines are closing on themselves. They're not all going from minus infinity to plus infinity or vice versa, but they close on themselves. They're separated by this surface, which we call a separatrix, which puts magnetic field lines with different properties on both sides of it. This turns out to be of lower energy than this one. May find it hard to believe, but you can calculate the magnetic energy of this configuration. V square over 2, integrate over the volume. Go to this one, V square over 2, assume the plasma pressure is negligible, calculate the energy. You will find that this is lower energy than the other.
Thank you.
physics that actually goes. And here you see here the magnetic field being set up sufficiently far that it has this structure of field lines pointing in opposite directions. So the tendency to form the so-called X-point at distances that are sufficiently far from the Earth of the order of 40 to 50 Earth radii is very natural. Closer in, the magnetic field which is produced by the dipole destroys that structure. And one of the misconceptions that people had was, and this goes likely to reconnect way out there because this component of the magnetic field is strong. But out here, this will have a strong field like the solar wave. The magnetic field has a strong field. Substrong physics, if you look at the old literature of the 70s, people were talking about how strongly we connected this magnetic field to the presence of a strong dipole. But higher and higher rates are stronger than this field. Which actually does much better. This actually now brings me Sweet's initial. Magnetic field is pointing in opposite directions. over mu 0. Remember the equation that I'm going to put del B del T equal to 0. Delta times delta. That's not. Westrack actually figured out. Solve the problem, but not so fast. Remember, computers. Experiments, and this was something that was done in my group back in the 1994. Just start out with a coronal group at the time that I was. Start moving the photosphere. Point is that even though you pre-bias the system, thank you. enhanced resistivity. But there's another problem. Another problem is that all of these history to this, people thought there were dragons in the sky. But what really happens in these problems is that resistance goes for so big, respect greatly, and applied to the substorm, and this is a cartoon that I have already shown you. This is the classic of physics, where the planetary magnetic field flux is transported day side to the night side. Is set is really something that's still a lot of work going on in that. But what I want to show you is what it looks like from Professor Frank, who is deceased now, but he did some spectacular work in terms of what happens in substorm growth. And what he did with his camera is what he found was, you found this sudden intense bulge in the auroral cell. It was a quiet aurora. Bulge. that forms in the midnight sector and polar. And you can see this in this picture. Popular pictures see bulge of tennis now. It all happens very rapid time scale, order of a few minutes. Was actually flown to solve this problem. And I will return to this little later on, but what I want to tell you is that even before we had market satellites, jump in the current density, and then a rapid fall. About 1 minute, this is about 10 seconds. And so you can see the coordinate system drawn here. X is towards the sun, this is away. Y is west. Looking at the cross of current density, okay? There's a magnetic impact of plasma and similar to the reaction drive on the substrate. Nonsense, because theory is very constraining. Question? To understand the microscopic physics of this, and I said Sweet Parker is not a very good model. I'm going to have to therefore generalize my own slope. estimate of when these terms are important. And I'm going to quickly write them down for you. Very simple. Take the ratio 1 to 5, 1 to 2, 4, and 1 to 3. The resistive term is determined by the size of RM, which, by the way, is called a magnetic Reynolds number. One and two, L is the system size, and C over omega B is electron skin depth. By this, it's the convention. Compare the two. And one and three. And so what you come to this is the importance of the term depends on the length scale of the solution. S is a very small number. Then, if S is a very large number and eta E is very small, we're left with other terms in the equation. What people tried to do was to actually come up with models which will actually resolve the small scales to a better reconnection. Where is NHT good? Very good. When you scale, other actions happen. That ideal NHT here. Okay, so what are we going to do? What we're going to do is try to explore what it would take for us to get to regimes of fast reconnection, because we do know that resistive MHT with uniform resistivity doesn't take us there. So what we do is we work with a generalized Ohm's law and look at this particular term you have here. This term is your old friend, the resistive MHT term, and S is a very large number. But now what we have added to that is, I've written this equation as dimensionless form. This is electron inertia. This is the electron skin depth, dimensionalized to the system. The ion skin depth, electron and ion skin depth, is that you have the electron plasma frequency in E. The dimensionless scale term is scaled by electron inertia term. Electron inertia is buried in omega p. Then there is the ion skin depth term, which multiplies both the Hall current as well as the electron pressure gradient. If you look at that equation, side and move these terms. Simulations have been done now with what are called Hall MHT equations. What do Hall MHT equations have? This term, and they either keep this term or they keep the resistive MHT. You can do this using fluid simulations, or you can do it using particle and cell type of simulations. Imagine you set up this Harris sheet, and imagine that you have a magnetic field perpendicular to the plane of the board. That could be zero or not. Don't worry about the setup. Imagine that you just start this process. Driving flows from the boundary. This is what it looks like in resistive MHT. The current sheet, computer simulations have worked rather well. Now, I go to the same simulation and I turn on the Hall current. Guess what happens? What happens is that you get a remarkable action of the current sheet like this. Thank you. the resistive model. In the resistive model, look at Ez and eta jz. Ez is essentially eta jz, a constant and eta jz, identical structure. Eta is just the scale. When you put in these whole terms, these additional terms that I'm talking about in the same simulations, you get this transient phase, very short time, and then the system spontaneously go and adjusts and forms this structure. Are you guys with me? Flow channel, which was very narrow in of the Alphane speed, numerical results. Theory, and you can ask yourself the same in both. In other words, thank you for asking. We set up magnetic field forming in opposite direction, and you can do the simulation with either a magnetic field going or set up. And this is all, by the way, discussed in all these papers, and you're welcome. Look at them, my lecture will be put on the web. And you can ask yourself, what about people who do peak simulations? But in peak simulations, you know, pressure is not a scalar, it's a tensor in general. But the generalized Ohm's law still applies. And this is a particle in cell simulation, electron current density looks this exponent. Ion flows and ion flows, field lines are. Well, thank you. embarrassed to tell you this. We can't do this. I was going to show you an experimental result done in the laboratory. We checked this out. But let me just tell you that this theory has been checked out carefully, numerically, by Masaki Yamada and other people in the Princeton Plasma Physics Laboratory. For this, Masaki was given the Maxwell Prize. And what I want to point out to you is that the crucial parameter that controls the connection rate is the ion skin depth parameter. And here's the sweet Parker parameter, delta SP. The picture that we have is the following. Imagine about current sheet. At the very beginning, you start writing this current sheet. The sweet Parker width is not very narrow. It's actually quite large, but the sheet hasn't been down. Bounds on this. So going back to Otani's picture, so if you went and did this thing with a substar, what would happen? Now, instead of being able to simulation, do a Hall simulation. Now the initial condition is different. You're starting out with a dipolar field and you're pushing convection in. What happens is that from these are thin time scales, thin current shape tends down, and if you plot the current density, this was Otani's plot. What you find, in fact, is that there is a slow growth phase. This is where Parker dynamics, something like that, is given. Then as the thin current shape comes down and falls below the ion skin depth, you find a sudden growth in the current density. Then what happens in this two-dimensional simulation is that the current relaxes. At this time scale, it's not 10 seconds in our simulation, it's more than the order of several minutes. So two-dimensional theory by itself is not enough to explain rapid disruption. We're not going to QE, but that's not the story. And what you get out of QE is much faster time scale than you need by one day. Because I want to keep my focus on the medical connection. Now, 10 more minutes, I want to tell you about something that just happened in the last 7 or 15 minutes. Which is that we learned something out of resistive MHD that we weren't prepared for. And don't ask me why we missed it, but we did miss it. I said resistive MHD was no good for getting fast connection. Right? And you always got this second connection. In fact, that second connection and that which is stable is one of the huge assumptions that we want to do. But is it true, really, that if you go to very, very high numbers, you get this very, very connections that are always stable? It turns out that there is a very rapid instability in the system, which was discovered roughly around the time of 2007 and 2009. Actually, it was done by a graduate student on the new linear instability, a much more rapid one, that I worked out phenomenal too. And this actually led us to a very different scenario with high levels of the current sheet without even invoking all kinds of pressure gradients. And to show you the salient result of this theory is I'm going to show you a movie. This is the kind of simulations that you were doing, except that now we're doing high level number. Computational capabilities allow us to resolve this current sheet. What you're seeing is a current sheet shrinking down. Purely with a simulation, mind you, in Parker lab, look what happens. This sheet is violently unstable. These structures, which are magnetic islands, violent structures, small to big, the big ones fall as reconnection rate. What happens is if you plot it, I'm showing you a principal result of reconnection time. The reconnection time goes up as the Lennox number goes up. It goes up in 3.5 to the less. This is why we are getting into trouble. It's over 30, right? Now notice that when you have crossed the Lennox number of about 10.4, the reconnected flux has flattened out. Sorry, it took us this long. Because of the time, I can't tell you about all of that. But what I want to show you is some examples of numerical results, which was done by Li Jun Chen using cluster data. And she was examining magnetic islands in the Earth's magneto tail. And here is cluster, four spaces. To track islands is that imagine this satellite is crossing this, so you look at the BZ field and you go through this dipole structure. So she does a lot of detective work. This is just one way she does it. She looks at particle satellite data and she was looking at particle illumination. Her finding was rather remarkable. Reporting this, she saw about 10 islands in 10 minutes. And on circulation, yeah, it's enrolled. You know, we still don't have in-situ programs, but we hear more of our graduate students actually studying OCME currencies and identify density law. A very nice work was also done by our state. University Dana and his colleagues have done very nice work on this as well. But if you allow the fancy imagination that you actually identify density law as some sort of a presence of plasma, then you could do a synthesis of all of this. And what is interesting about these is that the plasmoids are actually much larger than the thin current sheets. The thin current sheets are out of resolve. They're so narrow that you can't really see them. They're below resolution. The plasmoids are much larger. They can even become system size that the system feels, and you can deal with several blocks. So maybe you can see the plasma and then you can resolve the formation. It is one of those things that we need to do in the world. I'm just going to stop there because, you know, there's a lot to tell you, and I had aspirations, and this will be there. This theory has 3D aspects, but with the time I have, I want to end with this. You know, I had a nice sabbatical year in Paris, so I went to the beginning, and so I thought of the dimension of the synthesis of the plasma. You know, the synthesis of the plasma, right? All this is not wrong. So it becomes slowed down. So the reaction is seamless phenomenon that is occurring, and being in France, the struggle itself is enough to fill a man's heart. One must imagine this is what's happening. And living in connection is a very happy phenomenon. It shows up in multiple number of ways and keeps us mystified by all the things that we do.